Hello, welcome to Cityscope. This is the LTV show that focuses on people, places, things, events, anything that happens in and around Leominster. We try to talk about it and bring it to you. Today, my name is Carl Piermarini, by the way, and today we have, I've been waiting to do this interview forever, for a long, long time. I'm going to be talking to the LTV's first Hall of Fame member from 2009, I believe it was. Her name is Barbara Foster. You may recognize that name because she's had a show that has been playing on LTV and other local channels here for close to 45 years. And perhaps, we're not sure, but we're checking into this, this may be the longest running original hosted talk show in the country, perhaps the world.
Oh,
who knows? I don't know. We got to check this out. If any of you like to do research out there, let's see if we can figure this out. Her show is currently produced through the facilities of FATV in Fitchburg and is seen on local cable in many communities throughout Massachusetts, and including here on LTV. Barbara, do you have any clue how many stations you air your program on?
Well, there's seven here in North Central Massachusetts.
Okay.
But of course, as you know, nowadays, anybody anywhere can get the show.
Right, that's
which
true.
Which is kind of fun.
In the world, anywhere in the world.
Yes, it's amazing.
Well, anyway, welcome, Barbara. I appreciate you taking the time to do this interview. And today we're going to turn the tables on you. I've been waiting to do this. We should have did this in 2009. Why we didn't, I don't know, but we're ready now. Are you ready?
I'm ready, and I love being interviewed because okay. I think the pressure is all on you to come up with the questions.
Well, we'll see. If I run out of questions, we'll just end the program, whatever. We'll see what happens.
Thank you, Carl.
Give us a short bio of yourself, where you were born? Bring us all the way back.
Okay. How long is this show?
Well, we'll make it short.
Everybody that knows me knows I'm from Cincinnati, Ohio. I won't go through the details of how I got from there to Fitchburg, Mass., but that's another story for another time. But career-wise, when I lived in Cincinnati, I did a lot of modeling, and I happen to be photogenic. I don't really know what makes one person photogenic and what another person is not, but I happen to be photogenic. And I did a lot of photography modeling. I did some runway modeling, but I'm really too short for that, so I just did a lot of photography. And as a matter of fact, my picture was on the Cincinnati telephone book for 3 years, and that was kind of an interesting event. And then I actually did some trade shows. I met when I was doing a show for the Merck Chemical Company in Chicago, Illinois, is when I met my ex-husband. And then we had the path that I eventually got to Fitchburg and took on a bunch more kids to raise. But that's, again, another story. But career-wise, how I got started on the TV show?
First of all, did you attend the University of Cincinnati? Did you?
I took some courses there, some journalism courses.
Okay.
But I got married at 16 and had my first child at 17.
Wow.
So I was changing diapers when the rest of my friends were out partying. But we've made up for lost time,
mm-hmm.
one way or
well,
another.
That's good, yeah.
But coming to Fitchburg was very different. I had not spent any time in New England. I had two children from my teenage marriage that I brought with me. I was married to a widower with four little boys aged 3, 10, 11, and 12. So I've raised them, and then we had one more, and so I ended up raising seven children. I tell everybody the marriage didn't last, but the parenting did. And I wasn't going to go there, Carl. See,
well, it's okay. We don't have to. We don't have to go there. We know your name has been changed a few times over the years.
Yeah.
We're not going to go there.
I tell people they need a scorecard to keep track of my names and my kids' names and all that. But anyway, as far as the TV show, I was not trained to do what I'm doing, and I used to think, there's somebody's going to catch me. They're going to find out I haven't been trained to do this.
Well, you had a journalism background, correct?
I took some journalism courses,
okay.
Yeah. But the show came about because I appeared on the game show To Tell the Truth, and I was an imposter of a woman's basketball team called The All-American Redheads. And the real person on that show, is, by the way, it's much more tame than the new version that's out now. But the real person was my height. The other model, who was also an imposter, was much taller than either one of us. But after that aired, and I did get 2 out of 4 votes. I was such a good liar. But when that show aired, then the Sentinel called me, and Pat Gogan from the Sentinel came to my home to interview me. And this was in 1974, I think, okay, or early 75. But in the interview, it came out that I'd done this modeling in Cincinnati, that I'd made a lot of TV commercials. And Ron Hamaker, who was the general manager of I think it might have still been Adams Russell then.
Right.
He called me and said, would you like to do a TV show? And they didn't have any live programming on cable. And that was in the good old days where they actually paid me, Carl. And I know in public access, nobody can get paid to do what I do. But I kind of got hooked on doing it. I love doing this. I love meeting people. But I do remember the first few shoots that I went on, I literally was looking over my shoulder thinking, I'm going to be caught. They're going to find out I don't belong here. I have no experience. I have no training. What am I doing here?
The interesting thing is, I remember Adams Russell back in 73 because I was in high school at the time, and I used to go there to volunteer once in a while. You probably, and I worked on your show a few times.
I do remember you.
Probably don't remember me. But that was an interesting place. It would be great if we had the videos of your To Tell the Truth appearance. I would love to see how that went. They probably don't exist anymore.
Well, I did send a letter, an email to Tell the Truth, telling them about my being on there in 1974, and would they like to have me on the new one? But I never thought about seeing if there's any archives.
I doubt it.
That would be a hoot.
In those days, the TV stations used to reuse their tapes. They would erase them and reuse them. So I doubt if a lot of those exist.
But I remember you at Adams Russell and the brothers, the two brothers, Dennis and Richie. And you were all musicians as well as everything else.
We had a lot of fun back then.
We're still having fun, Carl, aren't we? I think we are.
It goes back quite a ways. Let's talk a little bit about your talk show when it first started at Adams Russell. Do you remember some of your earliest guests, or was it just local people?
Well, let me tell you, first of all, it was a lot more difficult to get guests then as it is now when my phone's ringing and I'm booked until the middle of June right now. But I tried to do the show where I would have two guests at almost a half hour, and I would always have a singer on the show in the break in between. And I would just look for, I'd read the newspaper. I'd look for people that maybe were writers or artists and obviously singers and musicians. And it was just keeping my eyes and ears open to what's out there. And a lot of people say, oh, Barbara, you're so lucky, you just fall into things. Well, if I have any secret to success, the secret is not a secret, but be willing to make yourself vulnerable. I didn't, like I said, I wasn't sure I could do this, but I put a microphone in my hand. And one of the first things I did was a remote for the town of Harvard's Apple Blossom Festival Queen.
Wow.
And I covered and interviewed all the girls that were, and as a matter of fact, the girl who won, her parents came to me and asked me to be her chaperone to go to Pennsylvania for the national competition for the Apple Harvest Queen.
Wow.
And I accepted, and that was a neat experience.
Wow, that's unbelievable. All these stories, there's so many.
Anybody that knows me well knows I have a story for everything, and you mention a name, and I usually have a story about the person as well.
So you would just cold call these people and say, look, I have a local show, and you want to be on it, and they'd say, what do you mean, on TV? They would get nervous, right? So you had to try to convince them to come on with you?
There's still a little bit of that people, I was just talking about that with some people I interviewed who are performers and producers, and I said a lot of times producers and people that want to be behind the scenes don't want to be on camera.
Right.
Now, you do it all. You play both sides of the right. fence, but you know what I'm talking about.
Well, I do, yeah.
And for people like you and me, we like talking to a camera, and we don't understand those people that want to stay in the control room.
I think part of it is, and well, in my case, I'm naturally a shy guy, okay? But you turn a camera on me, and it's like I'm ready to go.
Did okay? you see the surprise look on my face? You're a shy guy?
So I don't know if you were like that when no. you were younger. If you weren't, no. you weren't shy at all. You could socially talk to people. And...
Actually, in the sixth grade, I had a teacher named Miss Hazelrod.
Yep.
And I'm surprised that this even happened. But Miss Hazelrod decided I was pretty good at telling stories. And if she had to leave the room to go to the office for whatever, she would have me go up in front of the class and tell a story, and I would make up these wild stories.
Very good.
But when I look back, I'm like surprised that I did that, because
right.
I was a geeky, yeah. very serious, yeah. nerdy kind of
yeah.
student.
That's what it takes.
Well, until I started dating, then everything right. that my grades went down and life changed.
So, from the beginning, you've been totally responsible for the content of your show,
I
right?
have.
You really didn't have another producer or somebody. You were kind of producer slash host from day one, correct?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Of course, like I said, now that I have a following, see, in those early days, I really had to scout around to find
right.
guests.
Right.
And like you say, convince them that,
right.
yes, you do want to come on and do my show. But now I can't keep up with it.
Right.
And, you know, people say, oh, let me tell you about so-and-so. You should get them on your show, but I'm booking so far out, I don't really. Well,
and also, it's, I mean, sometimes I'm amazed that you can get, you know, during your show, you organize a band, you know, you'll have a band appear at the same time, and or a singer, a performer in between, and then go back to a talk, you know, talking to the guests. It's just, it's amazing that you do, you organize the whole thing in it, and it comes off well. You probably have does Robin direct your show at FATV?
Yeah,
but it's well directed, well produced. It works. It really works, and you know, I for one appreciate you giving the musicians the time, you know, the chance to perform. That's a great service you do. It's just it's a wonderful show for the community.
Well, thank you. I don't do as many musicians like I used to try to have one on every show for that break.
Right.
What was Johnny Gerard? Remember
yes.
him?
Yeah.
I think it was him. Who started his song, and then he glanced at the monitor, and he said, oh, my gosh, I'm on TV.
And you would stop.
I think it was him.
It could be. Yeah, yeah.
I mean, you and I could go back and forth with all
oh,
the
yeah.
names we remember.
All these horror stories, so fun stories. You never know. So it seems to me like you like to not, well, does it come off the top of your head? Do you prepare questions ahead of time, or is it just spontaneous, you know, how you do the interviews?
It's mostly spontaneous.
Okay.
And I like it that way because then I may ask the question that the viewers are thinking
right.
of. And also, if you go over it, like when I'm briefing people in green room before
right.
we go on,
right.
I don't want to talk about what we're going to talk about on the air because then they get on the air and they think, well, I just told you that.
Right.
No, we weren't on the air then, you know.
Right, right.
So I do it like being spontaneous. For some reason, now that we're doing the Zoom interviews, my director would attest to this too, I seem to make more notes ahead of time than
right.
I did
well,
when I was doing it live.
Yes. Yeah.
But I always have to remember who, you know, to introduce at the beginning of my show who's coming on at 7:30 or the halfway mark.
Right.
And then at the end of that, I have to remember who's coming on next week. And of course, with Zooming, we're a week behind.
Exactly.
So it gets a little tricky.
Yeah, I guess.
You know.
Yeah, yeah. But it's you do a fantastic job. You're still doing it. Did you ever think you'd be doing this for this length of time?
No.
No?
Never, ever, ever. But I'm hanging in there. People say,
you sure are.
When are you quitting? I'm like, why?
Why
should I?
Yeah,
they're going to have to kick me out.
It.
And by the way,
yes.
let me thank LTV for being so cooperative, and you've always been helpful to me, and you air
well,
my show.
You know, I kind of feel bad, because when you first were starting, well, when we were first starting the station back in 2000, around there, 2001, 2002, we didn't have a studio set up yet. And I remember you came by one day and said, you know, can I do my show here? I'm doing it at the local Access 3 or whatever. And I don't know if there was a lag time between when you stopped there and when you... Probably not.
Let me tell you, I can tell you that story.
Yes, okay.
Remember, I have a story for everything. By that time it was cable. Well, no, it was actually AT&T.
Wow,
they bought
right.
it from Cablevision, and they didn't own it very long at all.
Right.
But the first thing they did was cancel the local programming.
Yeah.
And my John McNamara, who was my director then, he was out of a job. And I thought, oh, it's been 20-some years. Okay, so it's over now. And when the day I thought I was doing my last show, I got calls, I believe, from you. And from Lunenburg and from Fitchburg,
wow.
asking me if I was interested in bringing my show to
right.
their studio. And I, as I recall, maybe you can help me out
right.
if I'm wrong on some of this. I talked to each one,
yep.
and the reason I chose Fitchburg was because at that time they had the best studio, the most equipment, and we made a deal.
Yeah.
And here was the deal. Maybe I shouldn't reveal this.
It's okay.
But on public access, number one, they can't pay you. I had been getting paid for the show, so that was okay. I love what I do. I meet a lot of great people. But also, anybody coming in and off the street in those days, I don't know if it's still that way, if you want to have a show, you're entitled to have a show, but you have to
yes.
learn how to use the equipment.
Right. That's right.
You have to provide your crew.
Yes.
And
you have to
what
get trained.
Paul, I can't think of his last name now, but the one who hired me at that point, he made the deal that they would always provide me with a crew. I didn't have to worry about providing my own crew, and they would allow me to play it in other towns.
Right.
So that was those were the three deciding factors that I would go with.
Yeah, well, I remember, you know, when you came in to us, well, you came in to see our facility as we were getting it ready, and we weren't quite ready to go yet. And plus, you had told me at that time you had made a deal with Fitchburg
right.
To do that.
So let me say, you've come a long way, baby. This is quite the nice studio now.
We're getting there. I mean, it took us 20 years, you know, saving nest eggs over the years to be able to, you know, do something like
this. It's quite an achievement, this building that you have.
You know, COVID struck, and right at the time when we started this project, building this, that's when COVID decided. But it actually worked out good, because we were able, with the downtime from COVID, we were able to really focus on getting this move, because moving a TV studio, I don't want to go into it now, but it's a nightmare.
You can come on my show and I can interview you about that.
Okay.
What's it like to move a TV studio?
We'll do one in the future, sure. But yeah, it was really difficult, but you know, we got it done, you know, and it worked out good. We haven't had an open house yet or a ribbon cutting yet. We will, once COVID eases up a tiny bit more, we'll do that, but we haven't scheduled one yet, but we plan to do that.
Right.
Anyway.
One of the other questions that people always ask of me is, haven't you run out of guests? And I can honestly say, never.
Right.
There are so many interesting people. And as you know, I've got a long list of celebrities I've interviewed, and I enjoyed those, and they were great. But there's many more local people and local events, and they're interesting people. And everybody has a story.
Yes. Well, I know you've interviewed many, many celebrities over the years, okay? You know, and some of the ones that jump out at me is John Davidson, we had actually at our studio.
Right.
But you had Johnny Cash way back when, Freddie Fender, the list must go on and on and on.
It's pretty long listed, but when I do keep it written out
in
on my purse at all times, because people say, well, tell me some of the people you interviewed, and I can't remember them.
Right.
But when people look at the list, it's always Johnny Cash they're most impressed with.
Johnny Cash, how was that interview? Were you nervous, or was it?
Well, it was absolutely fabulous. And this was back in the days when acts would appear at the Wallace Civic Center.
Yes.
Like, if he was on tour and they had a free night, they'd rather do a small venue than, you know, being a musician, than not do anything.
Mm-hmm.
I also was hoping to interview his wife, but she was getting ready for the concert and didn't want to come out. But he agreed to the interview. Now, my brother had a nice record collection. My brother had a 45 Sun record back in Ohio, and I had him send it to me. And I did that with John Davidson, too.
Yeah.
It's a great way to start off. They're surprised if I pull out this old record. The one that I had for John Davidson, this was before the one I did here. I did that one at the Bull Run. But I didn't know it was the first album he'd ever recorded. And when I pulled that out, his face lit up. He said, that was my first recording. And I said, well, do you remember who wrote a tribute to you on the back of that album? He said, yeah, Carol Burnett. She was just starting out then, too.
Wow.
But surprisingly, a lot of people don't even know who John Davidson is today, but we won't tell him. But back to Johnny Cash.
Yes.
Do you want to hear my Johnny Cash
yes.
story?
Absolutely.
He was a perfect gentleman. He was very effusive, you know, talking about the days when he did drugs and drinking and,
right.
and how he's dedicated now never to stand up an audience, how he, you know, he'd hurt a lot of people, and just really a nice, nice person. And I'm going to say maybe 2 years later, he was appearing at Indian Ranch in Webster. And I got a hold of all the advance people and said, could I do another TV interview with him? And they agreed. So I take a crew and we go to Indian Ranch. And Johnny Cash isn't coming out. And they're saying, well, we'll get to you. And finally somebody comes out and they said, you know, Mr. Cash is really not well. And he apologizes sincerely, but he's not able to do your interview because he wants to be sure he does the concert. He vowed he would never stand up an audience
okay.
at a concert.
Yep.
So you know what Johnny Cash did?
Huh.
He sent out his son, John Carter Cash, for me to interview, and Marshall Grant, his band leader, for me to interview so I wouldn't go home empty-handed.
Very nice.
And I thought that was exceptional.
That's
very
nice.
Actually saw two men helping him get on stage.
Wow.
He was sweating profusely.
Yeah.
There's no doubt the man was very ill.
Right.
And he put on a show that the audience wouldn't
That's
have known
amazing.
He was sick.
Absolutely amazing.
So I think very highly
yeah.
of him. And I watch Man in Black every time it's on TV.
He seems like a super nice guy. He's gone now. But yeah, that looked like it was a fantastic interview.
It was.
Was your worst train wreck interview of all time?
Well, first of all, there's only two people who refused interviews. One was Martin Mull,
okay.
and one was Helen Reddy.
Wow, okay.
Helen Reddy was performing at the Wallace Civic Center, and sent her husband. They both let me come with my equipment and everything, and
right.
then stood me up.
Right.
So those are my least favorite people. what was the question?
Well, who was the most difficult
train
wreck?
Oh, difficult.
You know?
Well, I wouldn't call it a train wreck, but you remember the singer Jerry Vale?
Yes.
Okay. I asked Jerry Vale one question. I could have gone up and gone home because he was nonstop
wow.
talking for half
yeah.
an hour. One of the really most difficult interviews to get was George Plimpton. And some people don't know who he is, but he's the best-known participatory journalist, and he's played Major League Sports with every team to write about it for Sports Illustrated. So the Bruins were training at the Wallace Civic Center then, and he came to town to play goalie with them. Well, knowing what all he'd done in his career, I thought
right.
he'd be very mm-hmm. receptive to doing an interview mm-hmm. with me. And he was staying with what was the Holiday Inn then, which wasn't far from the cable
right.
station. And I got him on the phone a couple of times, told him who I was, what I wanted. And he never really said no, but he never really said yes. Well, I knew what time he had to be at the Civic Center every afternoon, so I parked myself at the door, the entrance where he would come in. He came in, this tall man, walked with a long stride, and as soon as he entered the door, I said, hi, I'm Barbara. We talked on the phone. He glanced at me. He never broke stride, and I'm almost running to keep up with his long legs, and my mouth is going as fast as my legs, and I'm like, my studio's come right in between where you're staying and here and this and that, and I'm giving him my best sales pitch. Now we're going down the stairs, and he's ready to go in the locker room. I stopped, and I yelled at him, and I said, remember how you felt when you went to play football with the Detroit Lions and they wouldn't let you? He looked at me and said, where do you want me and when?
Wow. See that?
So I got the interview. Now, the minute he was on camera, He oozed charm.
Of course.
Everything was hunky-dory, just fine and dandy.
Wow.
And we had a very good interview.
Nice.
And he came back to town a couple years later. He was a featured speaker at some event going on around town. And I got in touch with him and said, you may not remember me. He said, remember you? You almost followed me into the locker room. So I got my second interview. We even danced together that night.
Wow.
And
see
I got,
that?
Oh, well, nice. That, remember that Apple Fest that
yes.
I told you
yeah,
I went
I
to
remember.
In Pennsylvania?
Yeah. Yep.
I got to dance with the Green Acres guy,
Eddie Albert.
Eddie Albert?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I got to dance with him at that
nice.
Event.
Very nice. You know what? We should, we have the video clip. We'll probably go over a half an hour. It's not the end of the world. This is fine, because I got a few more questions
well,
I want to ask
you. I can
you.
Talk for an hour easily.
Okay. Well, when you're doing these interviews with these guests, how do you find, how do you get contacts with their representatives or their agents? So how do you find that info?
I got a good one on that.
Yeah?
Well, you find out who's their manager or who's their contact person, and
right.
you call them and tell them who you are, what you want to do, or whatever. And when Jerry Lee Lewis and Fats Domino were both performing at the Wallace Civic Center, I tried that, and everybody I talked to, they said they are absolutely, positively not doing any interviews at all. Newspaper, TV, radio, no, they're performing. So that afternoon of the concert, I figured, well, they are probably staying at the Marriott in Worcester. And as you know, celebrities usually don't register under their own
right,
name.
Right.
I called up and I asked for Fats Domino, and he answered his phone.
Nice.
I told him who I was and what I wanted. He said, sure, just come on backstage before the concert. So I hung up and called and asked for Jerry Lee Lewis. Same thing.
Wow.
He answered his phone. He said, well, sure, darling, you just come on backstage. And I forget, one question I asked him was why they called him Killer. And I think he just kind of laughed at that.
Yeah, yeah.
But they were both great guests. And Fats Domino, my youngest daughter, Jessica, was very young at the time. She was in awe of all the rings Fats Domino was wearing. But the problem was the manager, who was a little ticked off that I got my interview, he made me sit in the middle of the two of them. So it was like I was watching a ping pong match.
Yeah.
and you can't, it's hard to interview that way, as you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
But that was kind of a cool story.
That's cool.
And one of the other times my daughter was very impressed, and that was with Michael Dukakis, who I've interviewed maybe 8 times in my lifetime.
Right.
And I think he was governor when my daughter went with me, because I didn't have anybody to leave her with, and we interviewed Michael Dukakis, and when we left, and he's the kind of person, he has a charm about him.
Yes.
And he knows how to make you feel like you're the most important person, and
right.
that he would stay and talk to you all day, but then there's somebody over here giving the cut signal because they want to get him to the next event. But he is a very nice person.
Yep.
And so he was asking my little daughter what grade she was in, about her homework, about her teacher. And we were driving home from there, and she said, oh, Mommy, can't you marry him? And I said, no, honey, Mommy can't marry the Governor Dukakis. Uh-huh. Many years later, I was interviewing him again at a Chamber of Commerce meeting, and I told him that story. And he said, well, don't tell Kitty that story. And also, then after that event, I was telling him how my daughter was in grad school at BU and my son-in-law was in grad school at Northeastern, and he was teaching at Northeastern. He said, well, tell him to stop by and see me. They walked into his office. He sat down and chatted with them for an hour or so. You know, a lot of people assume something is going to be difficult, so they never try. But I have so many examples of just really nice, genuine people.
Yeah. That's good. Now, I think I remember seeing some footage of you interviewing Buddy Rich.
Oh, that was at Fitchburg State.
How was Buddy Rich? Because I have a Buddy Rich story.
Yeah. I have a Buddy Rich story, yeah. I admired him. I always liked him as a drummer. And he was appearing at Fitchburg State. And so it was on a stage at Fitchburg State. And I guess we were maybe a little closer than you and I are now. We were pretty much facing each other. And he wasn't a bad interview subject, but he was smoking a cigarette the whole while. And at one point in the interview, he decided to flip that cigarette over my shoulder. Why? Why?
Because he's Buddy Rich.
Yeah.
No, I used to, my parents, my dad was a big band fanatic and used to take me and my brothers to see Buddy Rich's band every time it was around. So one time they were playing at the Civic Center, Wallace Civic Center, and I was maybe, I don't know how old I was, 12, 11 or 12, something like that. And I saw Buddy sitting on the side, you know, at a table talking to somebody. So I asked my dad, I said, can I go get his autograph? He says, yeah, go ahead, you know, go. So I went over and I waited, you know, they were talking and I waited till they stopped. And I said, excuse me, Mr. Rich, can I have your autograph? And he turned around and said, F off, kid. And he used the real word.
Oh,
the real word.
The big
F word.
Yeah.
And that left an impression on me.
You didn't like him as much after that.
I still like him as the best drummer in the world, and his band is one of the best big bands that ever. But personally, wasn't too good of a guy.
Yeah.
But anyway.
I wish I had brought my list of, because I'm trying to think of a group that I can't even remember their name now. But it was another group that was big at the time that played at the Civic Center. And then I interviewed them after their performance, and they had me up dancing with them, and my kids were all there being ushers so they could get in the show free and all that. I can't think of their name right now, that group. But another one that was a really nice interview was Arthur Fiedler. The Pops were there at the Civic Center. And of course, as you know, the floor is over top of the ice.
Right.
And we were going to do the interview with Arthur Fiedler before the concert.
Right.
Well, we had some problem with the equipment, and I asked him if he would mind if we did it after the concert. He said, well, as long as you let me wear my jacket, because it's so cold in here.
Right, right.
And then that same evening, the concert master, the violinist,
yes.
You know,
yes.
The concert master comes up to me and says, you know my son-in-law. I said, I do. Harry Ellis, Kitty's father.
That's right.
Yeah.
Harry Ellis Dixon. He was the concert master. Yeah. Wow. That's... Now, when you do these interviews, do you just do short questions and hoping they fill in, or do you kind of let them lead the way, or do you steer things, or what? You're laughing.
Well, because it's terrible when you do a short question and they do a really short answer.
That's true.
Know, so I would say it's a mixture.
Okay.
You know, my director, Robin, could probably tell you better than I can what my style is. I don't think I have a set style.
Right.
I enjoy talking to people, and I do find in my private life, I ask a lot of questions.
Right.
And the thing I try to do is tell people, and I mean it, the show isn't about me. And my job is to get you talking when I'm interviewing you. And some national people, in my opinion, just my opinion, folks, but Katie Couric and Bryant Gumbel, they were not just interviewers. They wanted you to know, tell you about themselves.
Yes. Yep.
And I'm only telling about myself because Carl asked me to.
Right.
But normally I try to just, and that's part of what I love about doing it too, is when you can shine a spotlight on somebody who deserves recognition and they've never gotten it before.
That's right. Very good.
And then I'm also a writer, so many times I was able to write articles about the same people that I had interviewed. Actually, I think I did publish one about Johnny Cash, and Merle Haggard sold it to a magazine.
Right.
But there's unknown people that, you know, there was a bus driver in the Fitchburg-Lemonster area who couldn't read or write. He was driving buses, and he ended up teaching himself how to read and write. Mm. Mr. Rines, R-I-N-E-S. Mm. And I ended up selling an article about him to the Worcester Telegram. And it was like nobody ever really noticed how bright this man was, that he could teach himself as an adult to read and write. He knew all the scriptures. And it just felt, a lot of feel-good.
It goes to show you that everybody has a story or an interesting background. If, you know, it could be anybody, right? Next, somebody walking down the street, they could be the most interesting person in the world and you don't realize it, you know what I'm saying? But if somebody was starting out and wants to get into this type of a career as, you know, a talk show host or an interview, what kind of suggestions would you give them?
First of all, I would say go for it. Don't assume it's going to be too difficult. What price are you willing to pay to get to that point? Because, I mean, it's still very time consuming, but I enjoy the end result. Yeah, have confidence in yourself and just go for it. If you have a dream, as a matter of fact, I say this often, in 44 years of interviewing people, I've determined that more people end up in their careers by accident than design. There's very few people who know at a young age what they want to do and actually follow up and do it. And one example I mentioned, her name is Marnie McLean. And Marnie is my former niece in one of those marriages. Mm-hmm. But anyway, Marnie, when she was in the seventh grade, she interviewed me and wrote an article about me for the Oakmont school paper. But she knew that at that point she wanted to be in television. Her goal was to be on Channel 5. She went to Emerson. She interned with me when she was in college. She was a news anchor on Channel 5 for a short period of time and she was also a NESN. Yes. And then she moved up to Maine, and she was on the air in Maine. But she's one of those examples of somebody who knew what they wanted to do.
And they just went far.
And speaking of NECN, reminds me of Stahl. What's his first name?
Leslie? No.
No. I can picture him. R.D. It was initials.
Oh, R.D.
Stahl.
Okay.
So one day my daughter answers the phone, and this rich voice says, "Hi, this is Artie Saul. I'm calling for Barbara." And my Jessica got so excited. "Mommy, it's Artie Saul on the phone." But I had gotten in touch with him and left a message that I wanted to interview him, which of course I did. I do find because I don't think I'm hardened to it, but because I've been doing this so long, I don't go after the celebrity interviews like I used to do. That was a challenge. And then again, like I said, I don't have to make an effort to keep my show booked.
Right. Well, that brings us to the next question. How much longer do you think you're going to continue, Barbara and you?
I want to make 50 years at least.
Okay.
And I appreciate the fact that you have tried to do some research, and I hope you do. I hope you do prove right that I'm the longest running live show. Or
it's difficult. There's a lot of access stations out there that go back 45 years, but most of the shows that have been continuous are things like council meetings or school committee meetings or, you know, government type shows, not, you know, talk shows with the same original host for 45 continuous years. That's the thing. So we'll have to do more research, and we'll have to see if we can come up with
that. But in all fairness, I have to say I only do it once a week.
Right.
You know, people, now Johnny Carson was on for 30 years, but he did it every day.
Well,
and Oprah, and, you know, I only do it once a week.
Even once a week, it's a lot of work, and plus you have your other careers, too, that you work on. So so it's tough to balance that out, but you do a great job.
I raised seven kids. I am a freelance writer, and when I was raising my seven children, I was publishing one article a month consecutively for 5 years. And then, of course, most people know I'm with foster
relatives. So seven kids. How many grandkids?
Yeah. Right. I have a dozen grandkids and four great-grandkids.
God bless.
The youngest one I haven't seen. He was born in October. Mm-hmm. And ironically, my daughter-in-law's father was born the year of the 1918 pandemic. And then her grandson was born.
That's amazing.
During our pandemic, and so I'm hoping to get to see that little guy. I have four great-grandchildren.
So. It'll come. It's coming soon, I think. You'll get to see him.
But, my family's my greatest blessing.
Oh, yeah. Well, why don't we take a second here, and we're going to give the heads up to keep. We're going to show a little video I put together now. Don't get... it's very syrupy, and because the song I used, I love the song. So, but it doesn't mean anything. It doesn't mean that you're going to stop doing your show or you're going anywhere. It's just a song that I like, and I thought it matched what we were going to look at. So,
see this too?
Well, if you look at the monitor right there,
yes, sir.
That big one, we'll take a look at it.
All right.
Okay.
Good evening. I'm Barbara Foster, and this is the Barbara and You Show, and I'm so glad you could join us. Thank you.
you.
Oh my gosh, how old?
Always. With a love that's true. Always. When the things you've planned need a helping hand, I will understand. Always, always. Days may not be fair. That's when I'll be there, always. Not for just an hour, not for just a day, not for just a year, but always.
We're at the Sax Cinemas in Leominster, where about 1,800 people are gathered to see the world premiere of I Am the Cheese. One of the more exciting things that's happened to us here in Leominster, to have a Hollywood premiere right here in our own town, thanks to our native author, Bob Cormier, who wrote I Am the Cheese.
Time has arrived. Johnny Cash has arrived. Fans are standing around. Everyone's very excited. And I'm probably the most excited of all. Mr. Cash, I am so happy to meet you.
Thank you, Barbara. I'm excited, too. I'm glad to be here.
Your theme song is in the key of C, and I'm in the key.
Great. And, you know, a lot of people didn't even know you were.
Days may not be fair, always. But that's when I'll be there. Just an hour, no, not for just a day, not for just a year, but always.
I knew I could do it.
Oh, my goodness. Thank you. What a trip down memory. And I thought of the name. Dr. Hook and the Medicine Show was the name of the group that I couldn't remember before.
Oh, okay, yes.
They kept calling me Dinah Shore, which who I did interview her at some point,
too.
Did
you do an interview with her?
Yeah. And there was a couple other things I saw in there that I thought, oh, I forgot to talk about them. But, right. Wow, thank you. That took a lot of time for you to put that together.
It was fun. It brought me down, you know, memory lane. But, you know, it just made me think of a question when you was talking about... Who was it you were just mentioning, Dr.
Hook and the Medicine Show?
Yeah.
They were for a band.
So, well, that question now is like gone out of my head. But do you see, looking at these clips and seeing, you know, the progression and how things have changed, would you change anything? Would you have done anything differently?
Well, I'd go back and be young again. Can I do that?
Well, if I had my time machine out there, we could
That's
put you
right.
on there and you could go back.
No, I've just been very blessed and very fortunate to be able to do what I've been able to do.
Right.
And, everything changed, the technology. And when COVID started, I did my last live show March 10th. And then they kept, you may remember, we kept doing repeats.
Yes.
And it was May 5th before... Actually, it was Nate Glennie who convinced me to do the Zoom interviews.
Right.
And I'm very non-technical. Everybody right. will attest to that. But it's worked out well, and I'm very glad he talked me into doing that.
The interesting thing about Zoom interviews is it opens up whole new worlds for you because you can interview anyone in the world. Anyone.
The first interview we did on May 5th was when the 10-year census was coming about, and Fitchburg was trying to promote it a lot. So we had the mayor of Fitchburg and the senior vice president for the Census Bureau in New York City.
See? Yeah.
And next week I'll be interviewing the old friend that I used to model with from California.
I've done a few Zoom interviews and with people out in Hollywood or whatever, and they don't have decent cameras on their computers, you know. Oh. So it didn't look too good. So you can go online and buy a camera, a high def camera for like $30 that clips on your computer. So I would send them a camera, and they would clip it on there. And then I would get a great interview with somebody, and it looked good because they have a decent camera on it. So it opens up, you know, this whole Zoom, you know, COVID Skype thing opens up a whole new world for interviews, you know, which is great.
Well, and I have to credit my director, Robin Como, for setting me up with the better camera right. And a special light, because it's all in my kitchen, at the kitchen table, basically. Wow. I move the table once in a while to make the background look a little
right.
bit different.
Right.
But I'm still looking forward to going back in. Like this.
Yeah, in the studio.
Yeah,
there's nothing
like
a one-on-one with somebody there and being in a studio. I understand that.
Thank you so much. I hope I get a copy
of
that.
Well, I'll give you, no problem. I'll give you a copy.
The family's going to want to see that. Wow, thank you.
Well, you know, we're getting toward the end, so I just want to say thank you very much for coming and do this. Thank you for being you over the years. And, you know, you got to understand, your archive of shows from 40 years, I know you have a lot of them. You have many of them. You don't have them all, but you have many of them. That's going to be a precious commodity, in the future. I think, somebody that can take care of that archives, because it's, you know, you've got a lot of historical footage of people over the years and interviews, and it's just an amazing collection. So you should be congratulated for doing that.
Well, thank you. I'm feeling very humble at the moment. Thank you. Thank you so much. And as I said, my thanks to LTV also okay. for being so supportive and helpful over the years.
Well, again, thank you. And I guess we're going to wrap it up, guys. So maybe we'll get you on again now. Are you going to have a special thing on for your 45th?
Well, Robin hasn't told me all the details, okay. but I think something's in the works for June.
Well, let me know, because I want to come and watch when it's your 45th. I want to come and be in the audience and participate.
Okay.
So congratulations again, and thank you very much.
Well, thank you. My pleasure.
And thank you all for watching Cityscope on LTV, and stay tuned. Many more shows will be coming up. Thanks.